Money in a bank.
Oh! Why every time you do that? I can't believe it. All year long. Come on, Bill, you make me look bad.
The Dickie V jinx.
So now it's a one-point game.
Well, I mean, 9 out of 10 this far tonight, but maybe not enough.
But those misses certainly magnified in
the final minutes of a close game. Right now, shot selection becomes very important. Good timeout. Excellent timeout. Settle down. Over the strategy as to what you're going to do.
Timeout, a minute 29 left. UNCC with the ball when we come back. Along with Dick Vitale, Bob Rathman back at the Richmond Coliseum. Minute 29 remaining. Sun Belt title game. One-point basketball game, but UNCC in the lead, 78-77.
Basically, right now, both clubs going over strategy this time. They're going over score. They're going over all the little things, matchups. People want to, you know, right now, there's so much tension and emotion that goes on into a timeout. They want to make certain the coaches that every player knows exactly what's happening in terms of time right now on the clock, the strategy we want to run, matchups, foul situation. We're going to put the ball in the hands of Dinkins. There's no doubt about it.
There's the score. Now we're going to show you the two clocks. The shot clock is on the left at 39 seconds. The game clock on the right at a minute 29.
They're going to try to really deny the balls from Dinkins, number four. You watch right now. Cheeks is going to try to deny him the basketball. They want to now get the ball into his hands. They'll pop him out off the screen. There's the screen. They're holding him. They're holding him.
The hold on Chris Cheeks.
Yeah, they're holding. They're trying to deny him the ball. He tried to use the screen. There's a special art in reading the screen and how to come off the screen.
So now to the free throw line. Byron Dinkins of UNCC. He's 0-1 at the line tonight. He scored a game-high 24 points.
Look at his shooting from the free throw line. 90%.
It's a two-point lead for UNCC, 79-77, a minute 22 remaining.
He's a 73% shooter for the year, 90% shooting. I mean, you talk about clutch. Also, right here, UNCC shooting well on that line as well.
26 for Dinkins, 80-77.
It was ice cool on that line, I'll tell you something. It was cool as could be.
Steady is wide open.
Can't let a star player like that open. He's going to knock that down 9 out of 10 times.
And VCU has taken the timeout. They have two timeouts remaining. A minute 10 left, 80-79, UNCC on top. Oh, this has been a dandy. And the next one coming up on ESPN, it's going to be the Metro Atlantic Championship. And that will be pitting Fordham against LaSalle.
Well, when you see LaSalle, the people, Lionel Simmons, remember that name. You talk about all the great players in America. Lionel Simmons can play with all the supers. There's so many kids that don't get the national recognition. The Brian Shaws of the world at University of California, Santa Barbara, because of visibility. But let's get over here right now. And look at these Ram fans going bananas. What's amazing, we talked about it. The stars will get the ball and make the big play. Dinkins goes to the free throw line. He bangs down both. Come down to the other end of the floor. Who knocks down the jump shot? Stinney. It's amazing. The great players want the rock at pressure time.
Stinney has scored 25 for VCU. Dinkins 26 for UNCC. There's a one-point difference in the game.
Well, everything at stake right now. NCAA tournament berth. Championship of the Sun Belt Conference. MVP trophy in a tournament. Who's going to get the gold? Will it be Stinney or will it be Dinkins? It's got to go to the winner.
A minute 10 left. 80-79. UNCC.
Interesting to see the kind of strategy they've been pressuring all game long. They back out of the pressure right now. And they let them come up the court and they go to what looks like a straight man-to-man. Maybe they're going to fall back in the zone. And they're going to fall out into the zone right now to take away the one-on-one ability at Dinkins.
The shot clock on the left is 31. Game clock at 55. Blocking. Back out to Dinkins.
They go to a 1-3-1 set against the 2-3 zones. Go out even. Look at the diagonal open man. Skip pass, you were wide open.
Shot clock winding down. It's on the left of your screen. A one-point lead for UNCC.
The wings will be open if they reverse the ball to the wings or off the post. The wings shot will be there. Oh, they go right into the gut.
Locke lost the ball. Hanlon's got it. Held ball possession, VCU.
VCU with the big play all game long. UNCC has been making the big play, the big score when they had to, but right now they lose possession. Up they go.
30 seconds left in the game.
Will he get a timeout or will he let them get the shot? See, here's where I would get myself a timeout when they get across the line and settle up. Yeah, there's the timeout. Good call.
Dick, VCU has scored on all of UNCC's turnovers this half. VCU just turned it over, and now UNCC is on defense with the Rams trying to score to take the lead. We'll see what happens right after these messages.
As soon as this thriller is over, Fordham and LaSalle at the Meadowlands with another bid on the line from the Metro Atlantic. Let's now get it back to Richmond, VCU, and Charlotte in the thriller. Bob Rathman.
There's Mike Polio. You see him at that VCU sideline. The Rams with the basketball. UNCC, winless here against the Rams all time. And that goes back to the days of Cornbread Maxwell. 80-79, UNCC is leading the Rams to get it in.
Well, you know they're going to want to go to Stinney. He's going to guide us, carried them all year long, number 35. They can't telegraph it, though, into him. They're playing him tough defensively right now. Pursley playing him. He had a big defensive play yesterday in a little Pursley, number 35. But he wants him to get the good angle.
Another timeout for VCU with 11 seconds to go.
Well, down.
So the Rams are going to take one shot for the whole works.
Well, down one, I was just going to mention that, Bob. When you're down one like you are in this situation here, you don't want to take it to the buzzer. You want to give yourself an opportunity, if you miss, to have a little strategy involved. Maybe an offensive rebound, foul immediately, make them have to make the foul if they come over. Up with the ball so you get another shot. So you look to shoot the ball really with about 4 to 5 seconds so you have some time in the event you do not score.
Mike Polio talking it over with his Rams. Obviously, Dick, everybody's thinking about Bill Stinney and taking that last shot. If Stinney is covered, what's the next option for VCU?
Stinney's covered. Jeeks is a good driver. He's got good ability to go to the basket with the ball. But right now, I think you got to get the angle to get him the ball. They were in a 1-4 set. He was trying to get them to get the ball to the wing because that's the entry you'd like. As you look at the timeouts remaining, none for VCU. Charlotte with three. But right now, I would look to get him the basketball. Right there, number 35. Great players have a way to get free for the rock.
It's a one-point lead for UNCC. We'll watch it with you.
You know, when a game was on the line, if you had Jerry West or Oscar Robertson, I don't care, the whole place knew they were going to get the ball. But you know what? They got the ball. See, right now, time going down. Stinney down on those boxes.
Wilson. Blocky fouled by Stinney with 1 second left. And the 49ers are on the threshold. It was not Bill Stinney. It was Vince Wilson. And he missed.
Certainly not the kind of shot you would like to get after a designated timeout where you had a chance to set up a play. Wilson shooting an off-balance shot. Time was running down. They couldn't get the angle they wanted. Credit that to the defensive effort to Mullins and his team.
Situation.
Yeah, you're really hoping for the miracle right now. You got to foul immediately before time is not allowed. You have to watch out for the intentional foul because that's two shots in possession as well. So that's very important. But if you make a good effort to try and stop the ball, remember the clock does not start college basketball until the ball touches a player on the floor.
Here's a look at that last VCU shot.
See, right now, he saw him. Not that he deliberately didn't want to give him the ball, they didn't see him.
Lockheed, 1-1. That gives Charlotte a 2-point lead.
I missed the foul right there. See, I thought they had possession of the ball, but he missed the foul. He converts this now. Remember, the 3-point shot on a desperation shot can tie it.
Bonke again. Missed it. That'll do it. Bacon. No good. The UNCC 49ers are the Sun Belt champions.
Jeff Mullen, Tom Poole, go shakes Mike Polio's hand. What an outstanding game this was, Bob. Jubilation down in Charlotte. Celebration time. Going to the NCAA Big Dance.
The 49ers win it over VCU.
So a seventh team is in the field of 64. UNC Charlotte is in. Now VCU waiting with a record of 21-9. Outstanding performance of the night, Tom Garrick of Rutgers, 50 points. In the victory over Rhode Island, 104-73 as Rhode Island wins that game. And also tonight, George Mason has just taken the lead. Now Richmond, 67-66. 4 minutes to go in the Colonial Championship game. Our final score tonight, Charlotte wins the automatic bid out of the Sun Belt, 81-79. We're standing by to take it in New Jersey. The Metro Atlantic bid on the line between LaSalle and Fordham. We're going there next with Jim Kelly and Dan Bonner.
In East Rutherford, New Jersey, the LaSalle Explorers and the Fordham Rams, the championship in the MAC. Let's find out how they got here. First for Fordham, big wins over Army and then St. Peter's. And for LaSalle, victories over Manhattan and Holy Cross. Hi again, everybody. I'm Jim Kelly, our expert from the University of Virginia, Dan Bonner, a name most of you remember. Great game tonight in the MAC, a conference that is just 7 years young, known for wild and woolly finishes, and of course that automatic bid in the NCAA tournament. Now, first for Fordham, they've been in this championship game for 3 years, but this is the first time for Nick, so what kind of style might we expect?
Well, Nick McCartrick, in his first MAC championship game, is going to try to go inside. His team is a big team. They like to operate inside. They're not quite as quick as the LaSalle Explorers, so they're going to try to operate inside and have a little bit slower tempo game.
Okay, Danny, you talked about LaSalle. Everybody knows you've got to try and stop their main man, Lionel Simmons, the super sophomore, averaging just under 24 points a game. But my big friend here, you think you've got another key?
Tim Legler, a swingman, 6'4" senior, along with Lionel Simmons, was also on the All-MAC first team. He's an academic All-American. He averages almost 17 points a game. He's a deadly three-point shooter. So you may be able to stop Simmons inside, but then you've got Legler outside to worry about.
Well, for either the Rams or the Explorers, the season will come crashing to a halt in just about 40 minutes. We're just about set to jump it up. Let's check the starting lineups. First for Fordham, Parada, Paterno, O'Sullivan, Pedro, and Taylor in the backcourt. For LaSalle up front, Simmons and Legler. Conlon is the center. Overton and Tarr are the guards. So here we go. Nick Macharchuk, in his first year at Fordham, brings his Rams in 18-13. Speedy Morris, again, another 20 victory season. The Explorers 22 up and 9 down. 14-0 in MAC play.
Fordham starts in a man-to-man. You'll see them switch between man-to-man and a 2-3 zone most of the game.
And the turnover. Fordham.
You notice Pedro pulling the ball back, gets it here to Taylor, and the reason for that is Fordham would like to run as much time off the clock as possible, reduce the game to as few possessions as they can.
LaSalle in that 2-3 zone. Pedro works in the backcourt. Down low to O'Sullivan. Haven't had a shot yet. Finally, Taylor fires. And it's three.
And that's exactly what Fordham wants to do, run that clock and then get a good shot.
Legler brings it across. Nick Macharchuk up off the bench saying all of the Fordham Rams should get their hands up on defense.
2-3 zone now for the Rams.
Overton inside. Turnaround jumper by Simmons. And a quick outlet pass. Taylor brings it down. 3-0. Fordham on top.
The leading scorer for the Fordham Rams is number 35, Joe Paterno. He operates mainly inside. But the big fella, Danny O'Sullivan, is who Fordham wants to go to tonight.
In inside. Off it goes in the right wing. Paterno. In and out of the cone. O'Sullivan has it slapped away. Cut glass by Tim Legler.
You'll see an awful lot of that from the Fordham Rams. They've got 2 6-foot-5-inch forwards, Parada and O'Sullivan, who you get a look at there. Their game is penetration and going to the basket.
Pedro on the inbound. They look for O'Sullivan down low. Dangerous pass to Pedro. Pedro fires from three-point range and connects. Greg Pedro, a 41% three-point shooter, 49 of 120 on the year, 6-0, both from 19-9 or beyond for the Rams.
Now, Fordham's press, they press and then drop back into the 2-3 zone. Their press tonight is not designed to steal the ball as much as it is to slow LaSalle down.
Rich Taylor, his three-pointer was wide. Slapped around as Sullivan comes out. Did he travel? Larry Lembo says traveling.
His own man ran into them, but that's exactly what Fordham wants to do. They know LaSalle is a good shooting team. LaSalle is going to make some shots, obviously, but they want to limit it to one opportunity.
The Explorers, Danny, 22-9. They're 14-0 in the MAC, trying to become the first team to go through the regular season and the tournament undefeated. Inside pass, good anticipation, and the easy bucket underneath. So finally, the LaSalle Explorers get on the board. Simmons with two.
And Simmons, that's how he operates inside. Very effective. He was double-teamed, but he still had the quickness and the strength to get it up on the board.
Taylor works in the backcourt. Explorers staying in that zone. Paterno over on the right flank. Parada underneath to O'Sullivan.
Excellent catch by O'Sullivan. The Explorers were in a 1-3-1 zone that time. Legler had to guard O'Sullivan. He couldn't do it.
Overton almost lost it out of bounds on the left wing. Legler swings it back over to Carr. Carr will set it up.
Fordham showed man-to-man once. Otherwise, they've been in the 2-3 zone.
Easy bucket in and out of the cone. Pulled down. Legler battles for it. Has it stolen away by Parada. Pedro. Too hard, good play underneath. Craig Conlon with a big board. And of course, Lionel Simmons, the 6'6 sophomore out of South Philadelphia, with that easy bucket, his first field goal tonight, setting the new school record for season scoring.
Breaking the record of one very famous Mr. Tom Gola.
The old record, 750. That was set back in 1955. Nice kiss off the glass by Rich Carr.
Carr is an excellent penetrator, and one of the things that Fordham is worried about, even if they can contain Legler and Simmons, Carr and Conlon and Overton out there are all excellent players capable of scoring in double figures.
Pedro and Taylor working in the backcourt. Speedy Morris up off the bench, trying to get a little defense going. Parada underneath. Danny O'Sullivan slapped away cleanly, says Mickey Crowley. And the LaSalle Explorers trailing by four. Cross over the timeline. Overton, Philadelphia High School Player of the Year 2 years ago. Simmons gets it back to Overton.
Good job by Parada to play Simmons for the drive.
Fade away by Legler. Is way off the mark. And Pedro goes sky high to pull it down.
One thing about Fordham, both their guards are about 6'3", Jim, and so they do have a sizable advantage even at the guard spot.
LaSalle beating Fordham in the two previous meetings so far this year. 85-80 in the Bronx. Simmons had 27, Legler at 23 in that one. Fordham outscored LaSalle, 12-1 down the stretch, but too little too late. Off the mark, Conlon pulls it down.
Boy, and a good block out by Legler. He got his body into O'Sullivan and just moved him out from underneath.
O'Sullivan had 14 points and 11 rebounds. Danny in the second meeting at the Palestra, but LaSalle won handily, 76-51. Fadeaway is no good by Simmons and a foul.
Foul is against Parada. That shot right there by Simmons is just about what his range is. He's a much better slicer and driver to the basket than he is an outside shooter, and I'm sure Parada would prefer that he not foul him on that play.
Well, we talked about 751 points, the old mark, 750 by Tom Gola back in 55. Simmons is already the 11th all-time scorer in LaSalle history with 1,421 points. There is Tom Gola. Great career for the Explorers. Simmons connects to bring the Explorers to within three. A six-point lead, cut to three. We'll take a timeout.
George Mason in the green uniforms, Mel Proctor and Kevin Greavy. 8 seconds to go in the game. Richmond up by three.
That's what they're going to do. They're going to push it right on up and try to get something for themselves. A lot easier to take a three-pointer.
Earl Boyd's got to push it out. 5 seconds, four, and Davis trying to get off a shot. It's a three-pointer, just missed it. And Richmond escapes with a victory. And the Spider fans pour.
Richmond has the bid. They will go to the tournament for the third time in the 80s. They went in 84, they went in 86. They are going in 86. Ready tonight, we have seen another team join the big bracket in the sky. Out of the Sun Belt, our first game tonight, UNC Charlotte against VCU on the VCU home court in Richmond, the Sun Belt Final. Byron Dinkins, Player of the Year in the Sun Belt for Charlotte. Finishes off this break, he had 10 first half points, and Jeff Mullins, 49ers, leading it by four at the intermission. The Rams come back in the second half. Phil Stinney, fadeaway jumper. He had 25 points in the game. He might have thought he should have been the Player of the Year in the conference. Dinkins, red hot. Here's a three. That puts Charlotte up late. 74-70. Inside 15 seconds, Mike Polio's Rams down by a point in a one-point game with the championship on the line. Vince Wilson here just needs a two, doesn't need the three, doesn't get that much as in a thriller. 81-79, the final score as Charlotte wins it. Dinkins had 25 in that game, and also in that game, a 10-game losing streak in Richmond for Charlotte is broken. The first time that Charlotte's won the Sun Belt in 11 years, Dinkins finishing with 26. Stinney had the 25 points in that game. So Charlotte now is into the championship NCAA tournament, as is the champion of the Colonial Conference, the Richmond Spiders. For the third time this decade, a 74-71 victory. They went in 84. They went in 86. They're going this year, 88. So where do we stand right now? North Carolina A&T is in the field, of course. We saw that happen the other evening. Purdue out of the Big Ten. Cornell out of the Ivy. Southern out of the SWAC. Those teams, of course, all set. Now, joining these teams, Southwest Missouri State and the Mid-Continent, Tennessee Chattanooga, we saw their championship live last night. And tonight, Charlotte is in, as are the Richmond Spiders. So eight of the pieces of the puzzle is beginning to take shape. Of course, the official bracketing and all the at-large bids will be announced this coming Sunday. We'll have our selection show at 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Other scores to get you caught up on in the Ohio Valley. They're playing the first round at Campus Sites, Eastern Kentucky, number four seed with the win over Tennessee Tech. 85-71, Eastern now 18-10. They don't know who they're going to play next because the Ohio Valley Conference reseeds for the semifinal round. Austin Peay is the number three seed in that league with a three-point lead over Tennessee State. It was last year that Austin Peay won the OVC on a buzzer shot, went on to upset Illinois in the NCAA ranks. And also Middle Tennessee State, the second seed in the Ohio Valley, leads Youngstown State by the five-point margin in the second half. And the Blue Raiders looking for their fourth NCAA championship or appearance bid in the 1980s. Tight game at the Meadowlands. The Metro Atlantic bid on the line. LaSalle up by four. ESPN's NCAA basketball. Championship week. Brought to you by Konica Copiers. They work as hard as you do. By Metropolitan Life and affiliated companies. Get Met. It pays. And by Good News Plus, with the Lubra Smooth Strip for extra smoothness and comfort, only from Gillette. Lay it all right on Tom Garrick's hands, who had 32 first-half points. A 20-1 run here for Tom Pender's URI Rams in the first half. Later in the first half, watch Garrick watch the dish here to John Evans. Garrick gets the assist, Evans the hoop. 62-35 game at halftime, but here, late in the game, Garrick on the break. Count it, 50 points for Tom Garrick, the best performance in a conference tournament so far this year. That's the final, 104-73. He breaks the Atlantic 10 tournament record of 34 that was held by James Bailey and the arena record of the WVU Coliseum held by Austin Carr. The other game tonight being played in Morgantown, St. Joe's has the lead on Penn State of 23-14, the other quarterfinal. So right now in the bracketing of the Atlantic 10, Rhode Island knows it's going to be playing West Virginia tomorrow night at 9. And Temple waiting to see what happens between Penn State and St. Joe's, and we will have the final coming along on Wednesday evening as part of our championship week. And speaking of what's ahead, well, we've got, of course, Loyola and Santa Clara tonight right after SportsCenter. If we take it to the break, here's a look at what's ahead tonight. The balance of championship week, 20 bids to be decided right here. We'll be right back.
It's unanimous in Peoria. Bradley fans have been in Hawk heaven all season long, and why not? It's been a dream year for Hersey Hawkins. First in the nation in scoring, soon to be first round NBA draft pick, contender for National Player of the Year, and he's already moved past Larry Bird into number two on the conference all-time scoring list.
And that sets up one more very emotional evening for Hersey Hawkins here at Carver Arena in Peoria. If he can score 39 points in the Valley Tournament Championship game, he will become the all-time leading scorer in the history of the Missouri Valley Conference, and he would do it in his final appearance before the home crowd.
Back on Friday, Hersey finally got to meet the man who holds the record he's chasing, the Big O, Oscar Robertson, who racked up his total in only three seasons at Cincinnati.
Well, you know, I think any time you can put the ball in the basket, it gets anyone's attention, you know, and he can do that. So, you know, that's still part of the game, no matter what you say about it, because they're still keeping score, and I think it's going to really help him going into the pros.
I think I just want to go out and do whatever I can to help the team win, and if the record comes, then, you know, I'm happy. If not, then, you know, at least I can say I got close to it.
So the stage is set for a grand finale at the Valley Tournament. The Hawk averages 36. He needs 39. Can he do it?
There's your record, Oscar. Bye-bye.
The Hawkster.
The Hawkster.
I'm Mark Allen for ESPN.
A little more respect. Bye-bye to Oscar's record, please. I'm sure Hawkins doesn't feel that way. He scored 41 and 38 in the two tournament games up till now. That's our second game tonight at 9:30.
Follow Darren Queenan's blueprint. He's the number two national scorer, and with him, Lehigh's moved to this final as the fourth seed in the league. Tonight, Queenan can surpass both Wayman Tisdale and David Robinson on the all-time list. Lehigh's going to score. They've got three different 1,000-point men. But Lehigh plays Towson on the Towson home court tonight. The Bulldogs, the seventh seed, but they've just now gotten back to 500. It's March, and tonight, their dream is very much alive. Nightcap from Peoria, Illinois State, and number 12, Bradley. Hersey Hawkins has spent the last several weeks editing the Missouri Valley Conference record book, penciling in his name, and tonight, he could become the Valley's all-time scorer. But it's much more than just the Hawk. There's Donald Powell, who was scintillating off the bench in this weekend's semifinal. Bradley is averaging 97 points in this tournament. So don't despair, Bob Donawald. Your Redbirds, the only team to beat Bradley in Peoria this year. And that's the Illinois State job tonight as two more teams try to get on the case to KC.
We're live at the Towson Center in Towson, Maryland, where tonight a big home crowd will try to help its seventh-seeded Towson State team upset Lehigh and superstar Darren Queenan in the East Coast Conference Championship game. Hi again, everybody. I'm Gary Sparber, and we do have a title game in the ECC, Lehigh and Towson State. We want to tell you how these teams got here in the semifinal round played right here on Sunday. Now, Towson State, the number seven seed, they knocked off Ryder 59-56. Before that, they beat Michael Anderson, a number two-seeded Drexel, in a big upset. Lehigh, they were narrow winners over Lafayette by the score of 67-65. With me to do the ball game tonight is former Duquesne coach Mike Rice. And when you talk about a championship game and a conference tournament this week on ESPN, regardless of the conference, you're talking about a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, and it's called the NCAA tournament.
Well, Gary, this is one of the so-called academic conferences, but they have the same dreams. I talked to most of the players yesterday, and their dream is to be part of March Madness next week, and one of these teams, Lehigh or Towson State, will have that dream fulfilled.
When you talk East Coast Conference basketball, you talk Darren Queenan, and he of Lehigh is the key matchup tonight.
Well, Lehigh, of course, has a great basketball tradition. They've had one 20-game season in their history, so that's not great tradition. But Marty Johnson, of course, and Darren Queenan, they'll go at each other tonight. Darren is the second leading scorer, and of course, Marty is the second leading stealer in the NCAA, so that should be a great matchup.
Now, Towson State, certainly the underdog. How do they deal with Lehigh?
Well, Towson State, we've heard this so often, they have to set the tempo. If Marty Queenan has the ball, he's going to score, and of course, they have to have a slow game, keep it out of Marty's hands, and they'll do all right.
We do want to tell you that George Kostofsky is here, and he says he is Bob Lee's little league coach, and they're still upset here at Lehigh because Bob Lee said a couple of years ago that Lehigh, when they were 12 and 18, shouldn't have been in the NCAA tournament. Len, send it back right now to Bob in Connecticut.
Who? I could never hit a curveball. Towson State and Lehigh. Winner tonight goes to the NCAA tournament. There are two bids to be decided tonight. It's going to be a very busy night. The Atlantic 10 is in action. We'll have live reports on those semifinals happening in Morgantown. And through the evening, we'll have the story of the sudden and tragic passing today of Don Redden, a member of the 1986 LSU Final Four team. Tragic passing, another body blow to the LSU body politic in basketball. Also, a look at halftime of the East Coast Conference and the stars there. One major upset is brewing. We'll keep our eye on the North Atlantic and the ECAC tonight. Lots of 43-30 game at halftime, Lehigh leading Towson State. And tonight in our doubleheader with the Missouri Valley Conference game coming along right after the East Coast Conference, we're going to see the top two scorers in the nation. Hersey Hawkins for Bradley in our nightcap, the number one scorer in the nation. We're watching Darren Queen, the number two national scorer. It's apparent as you take a look at some of these players on the court of the East Coast Conference, yeah, this league's got some talent.
The league may not be front page national news, but two of its players are big time. The East Coast Conference can boast of a pair of stars, Michael Anderson, Drexel's point guard, and Lehigh forward Darren Queenan. Anderson at 5 feet 11 is another example that guys under 6 feet can still play this game and play it well. He can score, and he can run the club. Anderson's currently the all-time Philadelphia collegiate leader in assists and steals.
Well, I really never thought I was small, you know, until this year, and since they trying to push me for the Naismith Award, they've been bringing up my size a lot. But I don't think of myself as small, and I think I play bigger than how tall I am.
He's a bundle of joy. I call him controlled frivolity on the floor. I just love the way he does different things, and you may say, what is he doing when you're watching him? And all of a sudden, you know, he's made somebody happy with a pass behind his ear to a guy for a layup, something like that.
The pros are well aware of what he can do.
I think really what we're seeing is that there's a role for these people. If they can push the ball the length of the floor and just jam it down the throat of the defense, they're a value.
Queenan has been among the national scoring leaders all year. He's another NBA prospect, but he knows that as a pro, he'll have to handle the ball more, moving from forward to the two-guard spot.
For myself, I want to learn how to dribble anyway. I want to always knock what the critics say about me. I've been doing it since high school, and I want to do it forever.
I think he'll do it, and I think he can make a name for himself. I think he can get himself, you know, some of that cash.
Darren's success has been a surprise to some. Coming out of Norristown, PA, he was a small high school center, and he was not overwhelmed with scholarship offers.
I'm a great example, I think, for all the kids across America. I was a high school center. I was shunned by everybody, and Lehigh just happened to say, hey, we really think this guy has potential.
I think we're starting to bring some respectability to the conference, and I think people around the country are starting to find out about our conference.
And Darren Queenan, averaging 28.4 on the season. That's second in the country. In the first half, he shot 5 of 11 and 4 for 5 from the line. So 4 rebounds and 14 points for Darren Queenan. Back to Towson in just a moment.
We got Berger off balance, and Berger turned around and almost threw it back in, but the whistle had blown, and there's the fourth personal foul against Carlton Owen. Now Mergensina is going to check into the lineup here for Rhode Island. John Evans will sit down. Steve Berger, 0 for 1 at the line tonight, but a 77% shooter on the year. 5'11 sophomore from Boomer, West Virginia. Ties the game. He has 7 points.
Got to give the credit to these two clubs for walking up and making their free throws. Crew made his, Colson made his, and Berger's made the front end of his.
Tied at 62, 2:06 left in the game. Berger with 7 points, 7 rebounds now. And the lead goes back to West Virginia. 63-62 Mountaineers with 2:02 left in the game. Tom Garrick, who had 16 points in the first half, one in the second, but Carlton Owens has picked it up. He has 25 for the game now. Garrick working hard along the lane. The shot doesn't go when he's fouled. That one would have put Rhode Island back in front. And Garrick now is going to go to the free throw line with another opportunity to do it. The foul is number 4 on Herbie Brooks.
tough move by Garrett that time. He didn't see anybody from Rhode Island on his offensive end of it making a move to get open. So he took it upon himself to go to that baseline and work his way into that West Virginia defense. It was a tough shot, and he drew the foul.
John Evans back for Rhode Island. Morgan Cena to the bench. Tom Garrick, 1-for-2 at the line tonight. 81% shooter on the year. Best he can do is tie it now with 1:47 left in the game. A lot of foul trouble in this one. We're not at 63. A minute 47 to play. West Virginia basketball now. Stolen by Tom Garrick. Rhode Island has it. And Kenny Green slams it home. Rhodey goes back up as Kenny Green picks up his 12th point. 1:37 left in the game. Rhode Island leading 65-63.
And Brent, it was that part of the game that Rhode Island is so good at, stealing the basketball. They came up with a big one, and Tom Garrick got it.
Team averaging 10 steals a game for the season. They forced over 20 turnovers in this one.
We're down to it. West Virginia must score. Kirby Brooks, 19 on the shot clock, 1:13 in the game. Tyrone Shaw operating on a bad ankle. Kicks it back to Berger, 12 on the shot clock. They got to go.
9-8 on the shot clock.
They don't see it. I don't think Berger sees it.
Berger's got a shot from way outside, but one stick, and Kenny Green rebounds for Rhode Island with 51 seconds left in the game. Rhodey by two, 48 seconds left. West Virginia backing off on defense.
But I don't know how that ball stayed out. I thought it was in.
It was a heartbreaker around and around. 38 seconds left in the game. Rhode Island with a two-point lead. John Evans with a basketball. Kenny Green now, baseline. Colson, and he's fouled. They got the guy that they wanted. He's a 62% shooter. 28 seconds left in the game now. Gail Catlett in front of the Mountaineer bench.
Here's Colson in the corner right there. You see Chris Brooks with a reach in. There's the foul committed. Good idea by West Virginia. You wait till they move the ball, put the ball in the hands of the guy that doesn't shoot well, and you've got to have a good memory for the guys who are out there that don't shoot free throws well, and they got this one, but he has shot well tonight.
He just hit two. He's 3-for-5 on the year, and now Gail Catlett's going to call a timeout to make him wait. The last 2 years, Rhode Island has defeated West Virginia on this court during the regular season, then lost to them in the tournament. Trying to fight them off here.
That game is tight. Towson has crawled to within 2 points now of Lehigh, but we're going to take a break in just a second. We'll be back with more. Game. The seventh seed has made it now a two-point game midway in the second half. We'll, of course, get back to that. But it's coming out of free throw shooting now. URI in West Virginia. Let's get back to Fred and Larry.
There you see the clock. 28 seconds left. Rhode Island winning by two. Bonzi Colson trying to increase the lead. 3-for-5 at the line tonight. On the rim. Can't fall. Tom Gary came in to steal the rebound. Rhode Island still has the basketball. Carlton Owens dribbling near midcourt. He's the guy they want with it, either he or Garrick. They're both 80% shooters, and Garrick is fouled. And now with 21 seconds left, Tom Garrick, who got the steal to get the ball to Kenny Green for the dunk that got him the lead, just wiped a rebound on a missed free throw.
But I'm not sure where he came from. He was lined up in there. He got there so quickly, I don't think anybody suspected he was there.
Tyrone Shaw fouls out.
Watch it again. Now look at Garrick. Here's the foul committed right here. It's a blocking foul right there on Tyrone Shaw. Tom Garrick has had an outstanding basketball game. It was his offensive game in the first half, but in the second half, it's been his floor game.
Tom Garrick will go to the line. He has 18 points tonight. An 81% free thrower who's just 2-for-4 on the line tonight. Gail Catlett now is going to get Brett Vincent into his lineup. Tom Penders, the Rhode Island coach, his club up by two with 21 seconds to play.
Not sure what the discussion is all about.
The officials having a discussion here now. Now we're ready to shoot the free throw. Again, Rhode Island by two, 21 seconds left in the game. Gary misses. And
West Virginia with a 2-2 tie. 3 would give them the lead, and they're going to call timeout at midcourt. Tom Carrick, very uncharacteristically, having some problems at the free throw line, and now we have 16 seconds left in this game, and Rhode Island's lead is still 2 points. Rhode Island.
And the Mountaineers have the basketball. We'll get you back live for the conclusion, but at our other site, East Coast Conference title game, let's rejoin Gary Sparber and Mike Rice, because Lehigh is in a fight for its life against the seventh-seeded Towson State Tigers.
Well, we have Lehigh on top of Towson State, 57-53 at the Towson Center in Towson, Maryland, the East Coast Championship game, the winner going to the NCAA tournament. Lehigh was on top by 16 before halftime. Towson State now within 4. Gary Sparber with Mike Rice in Towson, and the home team on the comeback trail. This is Everett Cooper beating down low to Dwayne Martin. And they went Martin Johnson with 11:32 to go. Everett Cooper, this is Dwayne Martin, who's really been good off the bench. Muldrow to Cooper, and a great block by Queenan. And it's going to go Lehigh's way. What a play that was.
And what Lehigh...
11:23 to go here. Lehigh by 2. Right now, let's check in at our Connecticut studios with Bob Lee.
You can tell by the feeling in the pit of your stomach, you know it's March. Two-point game, West Virginia with the basketball. You're looking at a live picture. Fred White and Larry Conley. Mountaineers got to win this game to go to the NCAAs.
We are down to 7 seconds. Herbie Brooks in the lane. It's going to be a timeout called by West Virginia before they lost the ball. The timeout was called with 6 seconds left. Rhode Island wanted the traveling call.
When I saw the hand go up and the whistle blow, I was waiting for a block or charge or a travel.
I was too. And so was Rhode Island. The timeout had been called. That's the last West Virginia timeout. Let's recap. 6 seconds left in the game. Rhode Island by 2. If there would be a held ball, the possession would long. 65-63, Rhode Island. 6 seconds left in the game, and West Virginia with a basketball.
All right, let's watch Rhode Island's defense. Watch the ones at Garrick up front. Man to man.
Looking to get an inbound. Deep corner, Herbie Brooks. 4 seconds, 3 seconds. Berger off balance. Hit the top of the board. With 1 second left, it's going to be Rhode Island basketball. The ball hit the top of the board. It'll be Rhode Island ball with 1 second left. And Tom Penders is going to take his last time out to make sure that his club does what he wants.
Home court.
Bonzi Colson's got a good smart play. Throw it the length of the court. All you got to do is touch it. This game is over. Rhode Island has won it 65-63. That was good strategy, Larry.
Excellent play. Just throw the ball up in the air.
That's probably the result that'll put West Virginia in the NIT. Rhode Island at 25-5, looking good for at least the at-large bid. They play the winner of St. Joe's and Temple. Now you are back at a frantic game between Towson State and Lehigh. Let's rejoin Gary Sparber and Mike Rice.
Lehigh by 4 at the Towson Center in Towson, Maryland. East Coast Championship game. And Marty Johnson with it for Towson State, which has come from 16 points down to tie the game. Now down by 4 once again. Johnson looked at by Queen, and this is Bayes.
No one has been in their seat since the start of the second half.
63-61. Lair going down the lane. Gets the Queen, and we're going to get a blocking foul on Bayes. And he's got a bunch of fouls. How many is that? That's it for him. Bayes is done, and that's a big loss.
And if he steps in front of
Johnson, the chase for it, it will be Towson State ball. 27 seconds left, and the Tigers simply must curl up the three-pointers and pray.
Terry Truax has to be proud of this group of young men. They don't have a lot of weapons, but they have a lot of heart.
Well, a couple of years ago, Lehigh was 12-18 going against Georgetown in the round of 64. Fink fires and cannot hit. Jones can't hit. Muldrow turns, gets the foul. No foul call.
Well, I thought he got fouled.
What you should have said is he should have been.
He should have been, really. He did get the bucket, though, on the timeout. It's 82-75. Lehigh celebrating already as they head for the timeout. Let's watch the replay.
Wild shot. This This Towson team hasn't quit.
Oh, he got fouled.
He got fouled.
I feel better.
There was no doubt about it.
I was about to say, though, Lehigh this time going to the round of 64 with four players who are seniors who have played together for 3 years in the starting lineup. Sure, they're going to be an underdog. The Lehigh Brown and White are going to the NCAA tournament. The three-pointer by Fink will count, but it won't matter. It only affects the final score, which is Lehigh 84, Towson State 78. Lehigh wins the East Coast Conference Championship and moves on to the NCAA tournament. Terry Truax obviously disappointed. His team was the seventh seed. Lehigh able to win all three games on Towson State's court. Finally beat the host team in the tournament. Let's go back to Bob Lidge.
I tell you, Towson gave it their all, Gary. Did they ever. This lacrosse school really putting out a basketball exhibition tonight, but the Lehigh Engineers are in with their youthful head coach, Fran McCaffrey, and so they join the select but growing crew of teams that are in on championship week. Let's refresh your memory. Who has made the dance, the big bracket in the sky? Well, we can go all the way back to the weekend and tell you where we stand with teams that are into the field of 64. North Carolina A&T, Purdue. And by the way, we'll see Purdue live on our air on Wednesday. Cornell out of the Ivy, Southern, Southwest Missouri State, out of the Mid-Continent, Tennessee, Chattanooga. We saw that one happen live the other evening. And also now into the field, Charlotte the other night, last night, Richmond Spiders. We caught that conclusion. LaSalle, Loyola in that lifeboat drill last night, and Lehigh. So they are in, and there we go. Week action, the Missouri Valley Conference Final. Illinois State loves to play good team help defense. Peoria is the site where Bradley loves to rev it into high gear. They've got the nation's leading scorer in Hersey Hawkins, who at better than 35 points per game is in many people's minds the player of the year. You can decide for yourself tonight with a bid on the line. Let's go to the nation's heartland, Peoria.
And once again, we welcome those of you looking in around the country. This is the Missouri Valley Conference Championship game. The Redbirds of Illinois State and the Bradley Braves, separated by some 35 miles of Illinois Interstate 74. Bradley Braves break their huddle. We're just about set for the starting lineups for tonight's game as Bradley takes on Illinois State. Let's go to the public address announcer, Paul Herzog.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Carver and the Redbirds of Illinois State University
and the Bradley University Braves.
And now let's meet the starting lineups. And a forward for Illinois State, a 6'7 senior from Detroit, Michigan, 32, Cliff Peterson. And for Bradley, a 6'7 senior from Havana, Illinois, number 40, Trevor Tempe. Illinois State, a 6'6 senior from Oak Park, Michigan, 45, Tony Hollifield. And for Bradley, a 6'8 senior from Nowata, Oklahoma, 24, Donald Powell. At center for Illinois State, a 6'7 sophomore from North Chicago, Illinois, 52, Gerard Coleman. And for Bradley, a 6'8 sophomore from Springfield, Illinois, 53, Luke Jackson. And a guard for the Redbirds, a 6'4 sophomore from Mount Morris, Michigan, 43, Ricky Jackson. And for Bradley, a 5'11 junior from Chicago, number 12, Anthony. Guard for ISU, a 6'6 senior from Pekin, Illinois, 34, Matt Taphorn. And for Bradley, a 6'3 senior from Chicago, 33, Hershey Hawkins. The coaches in his 10th season at Illinois State, Bob Donawald. And in his second season at Bradley University, Stan Albeck. matchup as Bradley and Illinois State for the Missouri Valley Postseason Championship and an automatic berth in the NCAA. We'll be back.
At halftime, Bradley has a lead 37-29. All of college basketball shocked for the second time in just over 2 months by the death of a former LSU basketball star, 24-year-old Don Redden, a mainstay of the Final Four team for Louisiana State in 1986, died of a heart attack this morning in Baton Rouge, 24 years of age. Back in 1986, Don Redden was the MVP of a Southeastern Regional. LSU, a typical miracle finish, got all the way to the Final Four this year. In Dallas, Don Redden will be missed.
It's really like one of my family members being lost. It really hurt me this morning when I heard it. And, you know, you really get to think about it. And look, I'm, a year apart from Don, too. And, you know, it's just something that really hurt.
He really was my friend. He was the guy that helped me out when I was down, that called me, came to my room, that helped me out when I most needed when I first came here. And he was a real good friend of mine.
Of course, all the members of Don are great, you know, and if you had to say anything about him, it would be that, hey, he was a hard-working, all-American athlete.
Age 24. It was January 5th that Pete Maravich died at the age of 40 during a pickup game in California. The word we have from Baton Rouge, Don Redden will be buried nearby, almost next to Pete Maravich, in a Baton Rouge cemetery later this week.
ESPN's NCAA Basketball Championship Week, brought to you by Mitsubishi Motors, who invites you to come see the full line of cars and trucks. Mitsubishi, suddenly the obvious choice. By 7-Up, feels so good coming down. And by Metropolitan Life and affiliated companies. Get Met, it pays.
Wayne Larrabee with Mike Braddon as you take a look at the first half of play here in Peoria. Illinois State may have taken Bradley's best shot of the night. It was pretty impressive, and let's take a look at the statistics about this first half of play.
He knows right off the bat, Wayne, who he's going to throw the ball to. Then he lets the defense come to it.
Illinois State resumes offensively to start the second half. They trail by 8. Bradley opened up impressively, scoring the first 9 points of the game.
And their defense did it. Let's see how they approach the second half defensively, because that was the key in the first 5 minutes.
Peterson, not sure about that shot. Jackson with his first rebound of the night, believe it or not. Very important, the opening 5 minutes of the second half for the Redbirds. They have to hang in. Donald Powell up wide open.
Great pass by Anthony Manuel. Powell let the defense shift. He came in behind the defense, and Manuel found him.
Double-digit lead now for Bradley.
Key defensive matchup in the first half was Anthony Manuel on Jeff Harris, took him out of Illinois State's offensive pattern.
Jackson claims his second rebound. Manuel penetrates to Powell. Was on the rim. We'll watch it again.
Watch the Illinois State player's hand after the shot grab onto the rim. Here's the shot. There you see him hanging on the rim.
Hollowfield came up on the rim, and Stan Albeck wants goaltending called here. Now there's a Powell on the drive, the reverse. Hawkins lays it in. 27 for Hersey Hawkins.
When Coach Stan Albeck gets his timeout, he's going to take Hersey Hawkins out, and they're going to raise the roof, Wayne.
That's the substitution he wants to make.
Hawkins went over to kiss his mother and shook his dad's hand. How about that?
His final appearance as a member of the Bradley Braves at Carver Arena in Peoria.
Jesse Hawkins, not only does he know he's going to the NCAA, he knows he's going to the NBA, but most of all, he had a ball playing here at Bradley. And down from Westinghouse High School, he has been chosen as the MVP of the postseason tournament. Jackson on the rebound of the missed foul shot by Blair. Hawkins on the drive. He is 10 points away from the career record of Robertson. Had a foul coming up right here. Fouls on Hersey Hawkins, who still has a smile across his face. Four personal fouls on Hawkins, and they're going to take him out of the game. Standing ovation, Hersey Hawkins. Tell you what, there's a whole lot of love in this building right now for that youngster. He's had a career. Says it all very accurately. At the free throw line, Derek Stokes. There are Hersey's parents. Dad in the blue striped shirt. Mom in the white standing up next to him. Bradley with three. Hawkins is the MVP of the tournament, as we mentioned a moment ago. I like that, Ryan.
Well, I'll tell you what, Hawkins, if you consider the media pressure, all the attention that he's had to handle all year long, being the leading scorer, and still kept this team together, they're where they are today. There's no reason why he's not player of the year.
Stokes will have another one coming up, Bob Donwald. Here comes Jeff Harris. Braves on the run again off the rebound. Shell to Cass for three. Wilson tied up momentarily and got a whistle on the play.
A lot of people in there right now that normally don't play. A big thrill to be in a game like this for a lot of those youngsters.
Time winding down, and the Bradley Braves have won the Valley Championship. Congratulations to Stan Aldeck, Hersey Hawkins, and the Bradley Braves.
Seconds to play. Kendall, a good free throw shooting team. Now Shaney backs everyone off the line. Howard Evans turning around and saying something to his teammates. Kind of lonely down there by himself. All of his teammates are on the other end. 52 seconds left in the game. This one could give Temple the 6-point lead. In and out. It's a 5-point ball game. Will Rohde hunt the three right here? They're down five.
I think they will.
Cena. Well, making it all over Garrett. Garrett. 38 left in the game and a foul. Going to be Macon on the Garrett. It was on Mark Macon. It's his second personal foul. And that's a break for Rhode Island now with 38 seconds left. They're going to get Tom Garrick on the line. Well, for one thing, though, Fred, it takes him away from that three-point opportunity. And it means Temple gets the ball back. Garrick with a good move right down the middle. Macon makes the foul. It's a pretty intelligent move on the part of Mark Macon to go ahead and make that foul. He knows he's going to get the layup, force him to go to the line, and they know they've got the ball back. Garrick gets the first free throw. If he makes this one, it's going to be a three-point ball game. If Rhode Island fouls, they would like to foul Perry or Rivas, but they're not likely to have the ball in their hands. So Gary gets them both. And now turn it off. And now Temple will play that in. Rhode Island needs a steal right here, and they haven't been able to get many of them. Got a deflection, though.
Tell you what, he's going to knock it right back into our cameraman's face there. Look at Breeswick. Here's the back of it. Good shot. Good angle right here. You see Mergensen trying to deny the ball coming in. He got it to make it.
Temple has turned it over only five times all night. There might be the sixth. It is out of bounds to Rhode Island with 29 seconds left. Only the sixth turnover for Temple in this game. And Rhode got one.
Watch it again. Howard Evans and Carlton Owens going for the ball. Evans slaps it away. Joe Forty right there with the call. Pointing the other way to the guys in blue.
Rhode Island down three. 25 seconds left in the game. Owens works against Evans. Gary into the circle with it. Puts up a two-point try that won't fall. Rebound. Evans blocked by Perry. Cena runs it down in the corner. Takes it into the circle and is fouled with 12 seconds left in the game.
Are you surprised they didn't go for a three?
Absolutely. I was shocked that they didn't go for a three. I think they were trying to get the two and go back right back into their press. You see Howard Evans grab Mergensen right by the arm. Evans looks up to see how much time's left on the clock. And there are 12 seconds left. Dick Paparo, the official, looking at Mergensen. I think maybe he might have gotten hit in the eye. Mergensen is standing out of bounds, and Tom Pender is taking a moment before sending the trainer over there to talk to him, because if he does, he's either going to have to burn a timeout or take Cena out of the ballgame. If he makes a substitution here. He's got Steve. Cena was fouled, right?
Yes, Cena was fouled. He's got a finger in the eye.
Larry, he's got a kid on the bench. Steve Lane, who has hit 19 out of 20 free throw attempts this year.
Who do you think is going to shoot the free throws? Just guess. In your wildest imagination, who would you pull off the bench to use him? Because Cena's got this eye problem. Well, the trainer's gone now.
Mergensen's a 59% free throw shooter. He's got Steve Lane on the bench, who's at 19 out of 20.
Fred, you're not trying to say that, are you?
Well, the trainer's there, and guess who's coming into the ballgame? Steve Lane will walk onto the floor to shoot free throws for Mergensen. He has hit 19 out of 20. He's a 6'2 freshman who has not been in the game tonight. Now, you think this isn't tough. He's been sitting over there all night. They're going to ask him to come off cold and shoot the free throws.
But you know what's more important? What's going to happen after these free throws? He's got to make both of them so they can get the timeout, hopefully get Cena back in the game. Maybe that eye will heal. It'll have a miraculous healing just real quick.
So Cena, a 59% free throw. So 1-1. And it missed long. Temple has the basketball. Breeswick got knocked to the floor. Is it going to be a travel? No, it's a foul. A foul called on Kenny Green. Rhode Island wanted a traveling call, but it's a foul on Kenny Green with 10 seconds left in the game.
Well, the strategy didn't work, and Lane missed the front end of the 1-1.
Only his second miss this year. He was 19 out of 20 on the year. That shot went too strong. You don't suppose they had him miss on purpose, do you?
You know, that was running across my mind. I was wondering if perhaps they might have asked him to miss that and make it come long to go back and try for a three.
He may have. I would not eliminate that possibility. Breeswick, at the other end, picks up the free throw. And now it's a four-point lead for Rhode Island with 10 seconds to play, and this one could just about ice it for the number one ranked team in the country. Four-point lead for Temple, Rhode Island down four. Temple now by five. So Breeswick makes it a five-point lead, 8 seconds left. That'll just about ice it for the Owls. Owens' three-point try won't go. Breeswick digging. Lane gets it back. He's going to try a three from the deep corner. Won't go. It's over, and Temple has won it. They have defeated Rhode Island for the 23rd time in 23 tries. 68-63. Temple is the champion of the Atlantic 10 Conference Tournament. They are in the NCAA. Well, I don't, we'll have to wait for an invitation. Let's get back to Bob Lee.
I don't think, Fred, they're going to have to wait too long. What a gallant effort tonight by the Rams, and you saw why Temple is so tough. I cannot recall a better matchup of backcourts tonight. It's just tremendous watching Evans and Macon and Silk Owens and Tommy Garrett going at it. And now URI's record is up to 26-6. Temple, a gaunty 20. Let's check in on Michigan and Illinois. This has been a big battle all night. Jim Simpson and Quinn Buckner in Champaign.
25 points for Ken Battle. 25 points for Nick Anderson.
Oh!
And a missed jam by Michigan. Illinois running away with it. Blackwell!
They got it going now.
Michigan. The Wolverines will go down to their third straight defeat before Iowa Purdue tonight in Illinois. They're trailing by 16 with 2:10 to go.
And now that they're winning, they got the momentum. I mean, and this game is not over, but I don't think Michigan's got a very good chance right now.
Grant from the side. 2 points. Less than 2 minutes to go. Michigan's going to go home to play Ohio State on Saturday with three consecutive losses in the Big Ten and the NCAA coming up. They won't move up in the seedings in the NCAA, and Illinois just might do that.
Well, I think Illinois is doing a great job right now with a minute and a half to go. They've really helped themselves. They've come out and played aggressively, and they got a good shot to move up.
Bardo fouled by Vaught. Now they're going to say, no, it wasn't. Bardo was not walking with the ball, trying to get around the foul.
I think that was Yinsky Yabba who walked with the ball, but Bill Frieder has basically conceded this game. He's taking Gary Grant out of it.
Neil Robinson takes it all the way in and is fouled by Yabba, and I think that will count. Yabba and Anderson both there. The basket does count. And it was Kuyaba who fouled. Robinson now with 14 points. Has a chance to make it 15. But it's all over.
It basically is over. I thought that Illinois came out and played much more aggressively. They played like they had something to get accomplished here tonight. I thought Michigan did there in the second half. But after that, they just never seemed to get it going again.
Illinois led by 14 with 8:27 to go in the first half. Wound up leading by only 4 at the end of the half. And now with 1:16 to go, they're leading by 12. Robinson will get one to complete the three-point play. Kirk Taylor back in, the freshman for Michigan.
They got both Glenn Rice and Gary Grant are now sitting over there with Bill Frieder. One of the assistant coaches is talking to Rice, probably letting him know what he should be thinking about in games like this, because I think this is an example of some inexperience that allowed this game to be like this for Michigan.
And Blackwell playing his last ever game.
No doubt about it. Both those teams are going to the field of 64, but Michigan in a definite slump. In fact, now this will be their 9th consecutive loss visiting Illinois. They have not won in Champaign-Urbana since 1979. Illinois, number 19 in the country, number 4 in the Big Ten. They are making a strong move to get one of those top 4 seats possibly in.
Bob, thanks very much, and welcome to St. John Arena in Columbus, Ohio. We'll have more than 13,000 here tonight to see if Ohio State can keep its tournament hopes alive against the Big Ten champion, Purdue. Good evening, everybody. Mike Patrick along with Dick Vitale. Great to have you with us for Big Ten basketball. Interesting that we've seen so many fine teams this year, but Dick, Purdue has proven itself something special.
Well, there have been 4 really special teams. When you talk about Arizona, Oklahoma, Temple, and certainly Purdue, there's a reason for that, Mike, and it's very simple. Their formula says good defense, shot selection, and experience. They have 3 dynamite seniors. When you're talking the backcourt, Everett Stevens and Troy Lewis, and the guy on the baseline, Todd Mitchell, they know how to win. The big question mark is, what will they do at postseason tournament time?
Ohio State, on the other hand, has had 3 huge wins this year, Michigan, Iowa, and Illinois. But I know Gary Williams is convinced if he doesn't win tonight, he's not going to the NCAA.
Well, he was telling us that before the game, and he's 100% right. He needs to win right.
right now over one of the better teams in America, Purdue, to have any chance. And then he has a game with Michigan. I believe if he can beat Purdue and then at least play Michigan kind of tough down here in Ann Arbor, he'll have a chance. Maybe not a great chance, but at least a fighting chance. But they need that win here today.
It's senior night here in Columbus, and maybe that will be the thing that spurs Curtis Wilson on to have another big game against Purdue.
Last time they...
Championship week. Two more teams enter the field of 64 tonight. First, the ECAC Metro title, Monmouth and Fairleigh Dickinson. Wayne Zokes, coach of the year in the league, the first winning year in Division I for the Monmouth Hawks. Derek Thomas, a senior captain, runs this club. The experts predicted Monmouth would be ninth. Well, they're third, and they've advanced to the finals, just one win away from the big bracket. Tom Green's already taken FDU to the NCAA tournament. The Knights are on the verge of a school record for wins. These squads have split two, and now the rubber match. Two teams from Jersey on the banks of the Hackensack. Our second game tonight, the Southland Conference title from Denton, Texas. The Mean Green of North Texas State, it's their floor tonight, and it's been their league this year. They boast the coach, the player, and the newcomer of the year, and they are rolling with 10 straight wins. They've never been to the NCAA tournament. Tonight, the league champs play second place Northeast Louisiana. The Indians have won in Denton by 10 points in the regular season, and they'll have to do it again tonight at the Super Pit. The points of the compass converge. Northeast Louisiana, North Texas State for the Southland Conference bid.
Welcome, everyone, to the beautiful new Rothman Center in Teaneck, New Jersey, on the campus of Fairleigh Dickinson University, where tonight the Knights take on the Monmouth Hawks in the ECAC Metro Championship game, hoping to win the right to go to the NCAA tournament. The winner tonight gets the automatic berth. Hello, everybody. I'm Fred White, our analyst, Larry Connolly. Larry, it's going to be exciting in here tonight. People watching around the nation who are so used to a Temple, a Duke, and Arizona might wonder what Fairleigh Dickinson and Monmouth are all about. Should be an exciting night.
Fred, it will be. And for one thing, they're playing for pride. Secondly, they're playing to get into the NCAA championship. What's it worth? Take a look. Here are the numbers. If you're going to get into that first round, you're going to get yourself $230,700. And you look at the succeeding rounds and the amount of money you can pick up, $1,153,700 if you get to the Final Four. That is a big dream for one of these two clubs.
And beyond the money, you mentioned the pride. And Larry, if you look at the major conference tournaments around the country, probably most teams in the championship game know they're going. This one is winner take all. The loser's probably not going. The winner for sure is.
Fred, you're absolutely right. And what you're going to see is a game tonight between Monmouth, the club that really likes to take care of the ball. They won't speed it up. They want the score in the 60s. On the other end, you're going to see Fairleigh Dickinson want to push the ball up the floor. They're very fast.
The battle will be in Teaneck here between Monmouth and Fairleigh Dickinson. Right now, back to Bob Lee.
At halftime, the ECAC Metro Championship game, FDU leads Monmouth by the count of 47-33. Marist is not in the bracketing this year in the postseason. The Marist Red Fox is ineligible for the postseason. They're on NCAA probation. But that young man, Rick Smith, certainly is the best-known player in this conference.
The Duncan Dutchman, 7 feet 4 inches of Rick Smith. He's the franchise for Marist, last season's Player of the Year in the ECAC Metro. He was on the cutting edge of the foreign wave that entered college basketball in the early 80s, but Marist was hardly the only American school to express an interest.
I talked to Dale Brown, Coach LSU, but he said it would be better for me to go to junior college first. And I talked to a Division III school in Colorado.
But they let the big guy get away to tiny Marist in Poughkeepsie on the Hudson in New York State. Smits is a senior with impressive numbers. 20 points, nearly 10 rebounds, and 4 blocks a game. The Red Foxes are on probation, so Smith's season will end in early March, but NBA scouts are key to his every move.
He's been projected by a lot of people as being as high as the second best player in the country behind Danny Manning. And Marty Blake, who is the director of scouting in the NBA, has been on record saying he's potentially the number one pick in the NBA draft in 1988. So I think right now people are projecting him there. And that's nice for a kid coming from a smaller school, because most times a kid has to prove that. During senior year, he's basically just has to prove that he's as good as everybody thinks he is.
If I would have gone to a bigger school, I would have set the bench to my first 2 years. I only had 2 years of experience in basketball before coming here. So here at Marist, I started my first season. So I guess that's what made me improve.
He has developed, but both he and his coach see some room for improvement.
His offensive game is at a very high level right now. I think that for him to go into the NBA, he can do that right away. As far as the negative things right now, and he's totally aware of it, he needs to increase his upper body strength. He needs to become more of a dominating shot blocker and rebounder along with his defensive play.
There's so much room for improvement. Any aspect of the game, you know, offensively, defensively, I got to get much stronger. I feel like I have a tremendous way to go.
He might have a long way to go, perhaps, in the eyes of some pros, but he is a lottery selection. Marist sitting and watching this postseason, and Rick Smith's getting ready to see where he'll be playing next year in the NBA. We're at the half. We'll be back.
Tony Roberts, 24 seconds left in the game. That's going to do it. Roberts down to the corner to Latney. Latney drives to the circle. Gets his first field goal of the second half. 39 points now for Jamie Latney. 15-point lead, and Fairley Dickerson with a steal. Amari Riddick on the dribble. That's the ball game. On to the NCAAs for Fairley Dickerson. They win the ECAC Metro Championship, and the celebration begins. Good effort tonight for Fairley Dickerson.
Great basketball game. You got to give Latney credit. He led them in the first half. He was quiet in the second. But boy, he was a boomer in the first one.
Final score, Fairley Dickerson 90, Monmouth 75. The Knights are in the NCAA. Let's go back to Bob Lee.
They're jumping in Jersey tonight. 90-75, the Knights go. They were there in 85 where they gave Michigan a whale of a game. We'll see where they come out in the bracketing in our NCAA selection pairing show. That'll be Sunday at 6 Eastern time. We've got two more games. We're minutes away from taking you to the other bid to be determined tonight. Northeast Louisiana and North Texas State, the Southland Conference, live from Denton, Texas. And right after SportsCenter, action from the Pac-10 first-round game between Washington and Arizona State. So we'll take a look at how Washington, who had been on an uptick of late, see how they'll look tonight at 12 midnight, 9 Pacific time. Other games happening around the country tonight in the WAC. They're playing this in Provo. UTEP and New Mexico, critical game. One of these teams may not get a bid, and that fact could be possibly determined tonight in the minds of the committee. Critical injury in this game for UTEP as Kurt Miller of the Lobos takes the short jumper. They battle and battle and battle for the rebound, and UTEP's Antonio Davis, a 6'9 sophomore forward, turns his ankle on the way down, and at last report, he has not been back into the game. That game right now is at halftime. And UTEP has the count of 36.
Welcome to Madison Square Garden, the world's most famous arena.
Pittsburgh is the top seed of the Big East tournament. They've simply had a smashing year. But they'll be hard-pressed to hold off the explosive Orangemen of Syracuse, who boasts one of the nation's best point guards, Sherman Douglas. There are other stories. Seton Hall is the hottest team in the league, and they feature the hottest player, Mark Bryant. Then there's John Thompson's Georgetown Hoyas, the tournament's defending champion.
Syracuse throughout the year. Syracuse just rolled over them in their two regular season meetings. But today, things were a little bit different. Sherman Douglas with the alley-oop to Derek Coleman here. It's a 17-point Orangemen lead, but Boston College comes back. The freshman, Willie Foley. The hook over top of Cycli, and it goes. The Eagles pulled it within six. But Ronnie Cycli comes through at the line. That's right, Ron Cycli at the line. 10 of 13, including 10 in a row. That's a great sign for the Orange headed into the tournament. Syracuse puts it away on the break. Stephen Thompson, 67-53 is the final. Syracuse and the Orangemen advance in the Big East tournament with the win over the Boston College Eagles. More to come in just a moment. Stay with us as we'll return to the second half. Georgia Tech, plenty to come back against the Maryland Terrapins.
Like you did January the 28th at Greensboro as well. But J.R. Reed has the ball stripped by Cal Boyd.
Finds Sam Ivings for two of his 24, waked by seven early. But the Tar Heels went on a 21-1 run. Ranzino Smith with the bomb and the three-pointer. North Carolina was too strong inside as well. J.R. Reed blows through the lane and jams it. Carolina led 39-28 at half. Second half, Tar Heels pull away. Scott Williams with a three-pointer. That's a big guy from way back. 16 of his 20 in the second half. North Carolina runs a break. Madden gets it to Lebo. Makes a blind pass to J.R. Reed. It's the short jumper as Carolina goes on and wins it 83-62. So they advance trying to win for the first time at the tournament in the last 6 years. They're the number 9 team in the nation. Right now, let's go back to the ACC tournament to Jim.
Seton Hall leading by three with 2:20 to go in this Big East quarterfinal matchup from Madison Square Garden. I'm Bruce Beck, along with me, Bucky Waters, and Bucky, down the stretch we go. Seton Hall having again problems with the inbound pass. Morton tied up. He leads Bryant. Bryant knocks into McDonald. He's called for traveling. And Murray McDonald slow getting up. He took a vicious hit, but he's all right.
One more demonstration of courage out here today. Harry McDonald gets in front of a runaway truck. Mark Bryant sees nothing but fall. They called a walk before that. I think that might have been a bit of a cop-out. That was either a block or a charge. He didn't have time to walk.
2 minutes to play. Seton Hall by three. Georgetown has never led. They've made up a 17-point deficit in this second half. Tillman missing the three-pointer.
Right over Pookie's head.
Tillman penetrates. Out of bounds. Seton Hall ball. Timeout on the floor.
No timeout.
Georgetown has one timeout remaining. Seton Hall, three.
1:44 to play.
Again, Seton Hall has to look up the floor against this pressure now. They're getting themselves buried down along the baseline. Too conservative.
Sally to Wigington. Sally playing with four fouls. Wigington has been the only guy that's been able to handle the pressure.
Well, he attacks that press. Everybody else is looking parallel and back. He wants out of there.
Seton Hall looking to make a major step forward in their program. The Hoyas have never lost anyone besides Syracuse in the Big East tournament. Seton Hall looking for their first ever win in the quarterfinals. A lot on the line with a minute 15 to go.
B.J. Carlissimo going a long time with Pookie, and it's B.J. now calling timeout. He has two remaining.
The Georgetown Hoyas trying to stay alive against Seton Hall. Pirates have never won in the first round. Pac-10, however, Oregon and Stanford started the second half. It's all tied up 36-36. Let's go to Barry Tompkins and Dan Belwamany with the start of the second half.
Just underway in the second half. 15 seconds into the second half. 36 all. In it goes to Randy Grant. More of same, but Grant missed the shot. Too hot off the
glass. 42 seconds left in the game. Morton against Tillman. Double pump. Foul called. It's on Mark Tillman. And Morton will go to the line for two. Shot clock is off.
I think he took that ball down in there deep a little too soon to suit PJ. He put a lot of pressure on the defense, but I think Carlissimo would like to have had a little time run off that clock. There is no shot clock now. 38 seconds to the game, and Morton on the line, an 82% free throw shooter.
Charles Smith back in for the Hoyas. 38 seconds left in the game. Now Wigington leaves for defensive purposes, I would think.
Absolutely. And he gets a nice hand.
Morton 7-for-8 from the line in the game. He hits the first. Gerald Green replaced Wigington. Seton Hall leads by one.
I don't expect Georgetown to go for three. I think they're going to come down and take the first good shot. Not even a point now. A deuce can win it for him.
Hoyas with the basketball. 30 seconds in the game. Georgetown down by one. Dwayne Bryant to Mark Tillman against Salad.
It's an isolation. He's all by himself. And a foul call away from the ball on Seton Hall, Gerald Green. That is number four on Green. And the Hoyas will shoot one-on-one. As Cookie Wigington reports back in for Seton Hall.
Ramos
back in for Seton Hall, replacing Sally. 21 seconds remaining. Dwayne Bryant will shoot the one and one. And now Sam Jefferson, for the first time in the game, comes in.
And Smith goes out for the Hoyas. More size in there, trying to get on that offensive board if there's a miss.
Bryant 2 for 2 from the line of the game. Rebound Ramos with 19 seconds to go. Seton Hall leading by one. Wigington leads for Bryant. Bryant is fouled. And I think that's one of the other reasons that Jefferson was in there, to give a foul if he had to. 10 seconds to go.
Seton Hall now going with size in there in a better effort to get the offensive rebound if there's a miss. Well, the Hoyas had a chance. Down one with the one and one. They went with the big lineup to get the offensive board, but it came off quick and straight down. And Pookie Wigington got it out of there before anybody could get a hold of him and ran the clock down to 10.
Georgetown wants to talk about it. That's their last timeout.
Hall facing Georgetown. Let us move back once again to the Pac-10. Oregon and Stanford just near the beginning of the first half. Second half.
Keith Balderson leans in, misses the shot. 44-39, 5-point lead for Stanford. 16-40 remaining in the ballgame.
Bryant connects on the first. If Carlesimo wanted the pressure on anyone's shoulders, I'm sure he'd want it on his senior.
This one's not over, Bruce. Even if he makes this one.
Bryant hits both. Seton Hall leads by three. 10 seconds to go. Timeout on the court.
Seton Hall called timeout. John Thompson didn't have any to set it up. We'll see whether or not it works out to be an advantage for Georgetown, but now they have time to make the substitutions they want and to set up a final play.
The excitement of the Big East tournament. The buildup was great. It's difficult to match the buildup in action, but I think we've had it this game.
Well, I'd look for Seton Hall to go with a man-for-man press that is not going to foul under any circumstances.
Seton Hall Pirates. They were 1 point this season. We're 15-10 and struggling, coming off the loss to Georgetown after squandering a 14-point lead. Looking for that one real big win that can propel the program. This one would be that type of win. The Hoyas, far from dead. 10 seconds to play. They need a three-point play. Dwayne Bryant has some trouble. Here's Jaren Jackson with three. Good if it goes. And a timeout call, but there's no time remaining. The ball game is over. The Seton Hall Pirates have defeated the Hoyas and won their first ever Big East quarterfinal game.
61-58 is the final. The last time it took double overtime, Georgetown ousted Seton Hall. However, not this time, as Seton Hall, for the first time ever, wins in a quarterfinal game in a Big East tournament, 61-58. Back with more in just a moment, but first, before we go, let us tell you that Syracuse also defeated Boston College, 67-53. And actually, what was a hard-fought game in this one, Ron Cicely hit 10 of 13 free throws, including 10 in a row, and that made the difference, 67-53. Back with more in just a moment as we'll return to the Pac-10. Oregon and Stanford, it's in the second half. Stay with us. We'll be back.
The situation is this. Dwayne Davis has
just fallen over the top of Mark Griffith, committed the foul. He landed squarely up on top of his head and is very badly injured at this point. They are out there at the moment trying to stop the blood. This is Ralph Acker along with Dan Issel. We have 18 seconds to go in this ball game.
All right, so Clemson makes that one interesting. We have got a very interesting game on championship week at Kemper Arena, Nebraska, number 7 seed against K-State. Let's now join Jay Randolph and Gary Thompson.
Along with Gary Thompson, Jay Randolph here at Kemper Arena in Kansas City. 21 seconds remaining. Kansas State leading by one. They were tied 32-all at halftime. It looked like the Wildcats were in great shape about 2 minutes ago, but that has been the factor that the three-point play has made so important in college basketball, and Buchanan, with two big three-pointers, gets the Huskers back into this one. The Wildcats will have the basketball with 21 seconds left in regulation time. Bledsoe to put it in play. Gets it to Henson. And a foul charge.
Well, they got the ball to the right man.
One of the outstanding free throw shooters in America, Steve Henson, the sophomore, shooting better than 93% at the line. And Manning will return for Nebraska, number 35.
Regardless here, though, it gives Nebraska the opportunity. They're down one if he hits them both. They're down three. The three-point play keeps it alive for him.
Danny Nee talking things over. That foul was on Vic. It is his fourth personal foul.
You're Nebraska on that line. Look at Lon Kruger giving directions to what he wants his club to do defensively. But think about Nebraska. You've got Henson, a great free throw shooter. You do not want to relax up there and think of that ball, the first one's going in. You've got to be thinking about really checking off and securing this basketball.
Now Vic is fouled out, we're told.
And their leading scorer, 6 points tonight, averaging a little over 11 a ball game on the year.
Here's Henson. He has 5 points, averaging 8.8. Big basket. And if he can get this one, it would put the Cats up by three.
Well, we'll see if Kansas State puts the emphasis on guarding the three-point line. He makes this, which he does.
7 points for Henson. 73-70. This sellout crowd at Kemper on their feet. And the three-pointer by Johnson doesn't go. And here is a foul on Recaway as Henson came up with the ball.
See, sometimes I thought Johnson had the drive right there. They still had a timeout. You'll get the two-point goal easier in that situation. They had 19 seconds when it started many times. I think it's smart to go ahead and take it if you can get it on the drive real quick.
Nebraska's come so close in recent years in getting a victory over K-State. Henson is 7 out of 8 from the line tonight.
And we said earlier, 4 tournament games decided by 6 points. Again, another one down to the wire.
Henson does not have a field goal, but those 8 points are vitally important. Now a timeout for the Wildcats. 11 seconds remaining. The Cats leading at 74-70. Again, we'll recap it for you. It was 32 all at halftime. Nebraska went more than 5 minutes without scoring a point to start the second half. They have battled back. Buchanan got a couple of big three-pointers for them. It has been a game in which neither club has...
We'll pass along the final of that one, and the winner of that game looks like it's going to be Kansas State. We'll take on the winner of the nightcap in the Big 8 quarterfinals between Oklahoma State and Kansas. We'll have live reports on that one as well. Already today, Missouri with a win in the Big 8. And Oklahoma, 99 points today for the Sooners. Not quite 100. They had a win. North Carolina. So K-State, the number 2 seed in the Big 8, vanquishing number 7, Nebraska. Kansas State will, of course, hang out now and see what happens between Oklahoma State and Kansas and give those two teams a good look. Otis Levingston kicked off the Kansas team by Larry Brown the other day, so he will not be in action tonight. They had a troubled year in Lawrence, but still Kansas State looking good out of that conference. Will Iowa State go? A lot of questions out of the Big 8. We have seen North Carolina State with the win by the count of 79-72 over Clemson. So now in the bracketing of the Atlantic Coast Conference, the early semifinal tomorrow, North Carolina and Maryland, by virtue of their victories today in the Maryland spanking of Georgia Tech, may have put the Terps in the field of 64. That's our early game tomorrow in the ACC. And then North Carolina State now waiting to see what happens in our nightcap. And we'll be getting back there in a bit, a couple of minutes, Duke and Virginia in our nightcap. And also our final telecast tonight, right after SportsCenter, will be UCLA and Washington State from the Pac-10 right after SportsCenter at midnight Eastern time. And, of course, throughout the entire evening, we'll be switching about the country to all the action as we've just gone to the Big 8. We'll be going to the Big East and to the WAC and wherever the action will be happening. The action was happening at Madison Square Garden this evening. Connecticut did not shoot well in the second half, and that's basically what cost them the game against Pittsburgh in this quarterfinal game of the Big East. Pitt also had their transition game going, and this is what we mean. We talk about Pitt transition. Jerome Lane will outlet off the rebound, that's especially to Sean Miller, to Darrell Porter, to Charles Smith. Look out. Pitt cruising in the second half. 75-58, that final score. Pitt will take on the winner of the nightcap between Villanova and St. John's. Jerome Lane had 19 points, and Smith had 16 in that game. Surprise, perhaps, but Seton Hall lost once to Georgetown in New Jersey, went down to Landover, took the Hoyas to double overtime just last weekend. So you got to figure the old due theory, they were due, and Seton Hall rolled up a big lead at 14 points for P.J. Carlissimo at one juncture today, but then Charles Smith brings back Georgetown. He had 22, the blindside steal, the Hoyas with a 13-point run, the Pirates by one, but they never lost their head or the lead. Mark Bryant rejected by Anthony Allen here, 0-0, as it put back. But Pookie Wigginton throws his body into the mess, keeps it alive to Bryant, to Ramos with a slam. That was the backbreaker as the Pirates take a 4-point lead. Hoyas are only up by one, or I should say down by one, when Dwayne Bryant misses the front end of 1-1. And with 10 seconds to go, Mark Bryant, who is the franchise, coolly hits the 1-1. Seton Hall over Georgetown, 61-58. And for the first time ever, someone other than Syracuse has knocked the Hoyas out of the Big East Championship Tournament. Johnny Morton had 20 in that game for Seton Hall. Bryant had 10 rebounds and 16 points. Seton Hall takes on Syracuse tomorrow in one of the Big East semifinals. Syracuse, a winner, did not come easily over Boston College, 67-53. Stevie Thompson had 15 points, and the Orange, well, they won it by 14, but they got the last 8 points of the game. Dana Barros did not shoot well today. That hurt, of course, BC's effort. Now in the bracketing pit, waiting to see what happens between St. John's and Villanova, and the Redmen are warily watching the rest of the scoreboards around the country. They're on the bubble. Syracuse and the Hall get at it. And remember, the Hall took the Syracuse Orange, went down to a one-point game earlier this year, and that was in the Carrier Dome. In the early and large lead off the turnover, Charles Shackelford somehow gets it to Vinny Del Negro, 22-6. Shaq scoring almost at will. How does Lefty say it? Shaq take it to the rack? Well, he does. 40-30, that went ahead of foul. Can you believe that shot? State by 10 in the second half. Grayson Marshall on the break for Clemson, and the Tigers are only down by 4, and then they rally and tie this game. Latter part of the second half, they get it to Eldon Campbell. 63 apiece. Now, Jimmy Vino, he's got an NCAA bid, but he likes to stay alive and win this thing. Del Negro here, Vinny with a steal. The long pass to Shackelford, he had 26 on the game. State had a 14-point lead. It went down to nothing. They win it 79-72. They have now won six straight games as North Carolina State is seeking their third ACC tournament title in the last 6 years. And only one microphone and two guys named Vital and Valvano after the game. Let's listen.
Hey, your team has won more games than teams that you've had in the past. Is this the best team you've had in terms of a team concept?
Yes, it is. It is not. I don't think it's the most talented. I still say in 83, if Wittenberg didn't get hurt, I don't think we would have lost as many games as we did. But this club finds each other better. We have more assists. We had 16 assists in the first half. You know, back then, the only assist Wittenberg had, well, the only pass he made was at Sidney Lowe's girlfriend. That's about it. So I really like this ball club. Plus, it tends to do what it has to do to win. You know, we've done a pretty good job. We've never had a bad run.
83-41. That's a WAC semifinal. We'll be tracking.
Okay, Jim, we'll take you from Greensboro out to the WAC, where we have had upsets and near upsets and plenty of surprises. Wyoming in white with the ball in the lead, fighting for its life against Colorado State.
Joining us along ESPN around the country, our story here, 39 seconds left, 2-point Wyoming lead.
Kevin, I'll tell you what CSU must do. They must foul quickly twice. They cannot let this thing go all the way down with the 14 fouls. This thing is going to run out. Wyoming will try and keep it hot and try to avoid being fouled. This thing is over with the shot clock off unless they don't take care of the ball. They got to foul them quick, immediately.
They let Dembo alone.
I tell you, they're confused. They've got to come out or the game is over. They've got to foul him.
30 seconds left.
They're worried about fouling the shooter. It doesn't matter. Foul anybody. Just make sure it's not a two-shot foul. Let's see if they go two shots. They don't want two shots if you're on the Wyoming side. They want the ball out of bounds. That's five team fouls. One more to give.
23 seconds left. Kevin Slayton and Irv Brown, glad you could join us for the final moments of this telecast.
They have got to foul as soon as the ball is inbounded. Then they have to foul number 10, Sean Dent, for the seventh foul. Send him to the line. Right now you foul the first guy who touches it. Make sure it's not a two-shot foul.
Well, they nearly had a steal.
All right, that's number six. I tell you, Benny Smart, though. Sean Dent will pass the ball in. He'll try and make the foul. Dembo, timeout for Wyoming.
23 ticks left. This game had been all Colorado State all the way. They led nearly the entire ball game until the last minute when Wyoming made the comeback, took a four-point lead, then Durham scored to close it to two.
We'll get you back there for the conclusion. In the meantime, Jim Brando and Vic Vitale will return it to you, Duke and Virginia, the ACC quarterfinal. The winner of this one gets NC State.
And so far, Bob Lee, while we've been away, it's just been a continuation of what we had seen before. Duke dominant down low, forcing at least a foul. That one coming from Morton.
Lee's got more on what's going on in the WAC conference finale, Bob.
It's a semifinal game of the WAC, Tim, and we'll get back to a Colorado State in the dark uniforms, coached by Boyd Grant, who likes a deliberate style. That's Benny D's. This Wyoming team trying to hold on, Kevin Slayton.
Once again, we welcome ESPN and the viewers across the country back here to Provo. Kevin Slayton and Irv Brown, 23 seconds left, Wyoming by two. And there's the foul against Lechner, so the big senior from Manhattan Beach, California, a 76% free throw shooter on the year, will go to the line for the two most important ones so far in the season.
We had a game on national TV on ESPN. Closing seconds, Lechner was three in a row. There were two lane violations. He needs to hit one to assure his ball club of getting into an overtime. Two wins the basketball game unless something wild happens.
Oh, he missed it. Durham, 18 seconds left.
Do you go for three to try and win it? Tiny Grant's a gambler. He's liable to let Turcotte or Shippen go for three.
Bailey trying to penetrate. Turcotte's the man here with 5 seconds left. Off the baseline, we're tied with 3 seconds. This crowd has gone wild in Provo.
I'll tell you what's major important right now, what both coaches are talking about. Let's take a look at the effort here by Turcotte. Time running down, 3 seconds. Turcotte has been terrific tonight. He goes up, doesn't get in at the bottom of the net. Kevin, the one thing that must happen, CSU must not commit a foul. That's what Tiny Grant is telling his people. The second thing, Wyoming must make sure when they throw the ball inbounds, it touches somebody. They'll try and throw it long. If it doesn't touch somebody, it comes back to the original spot.
Well, you pointed it out so accurately, Irv, at the free throw line. Lechner having the problems down the stretch of past ball games, and he did it again here, missing, giving Colorado State the chance to tie, which they did. And they did it perfectly. They didn't give Wyoming much of a chance to win the ball game in regulation time. Just 2 seconds left.
See what I like? The CSU came down and attacked. They didn't use the timeout because that lets Wyoming set up a defense. Turcotte used his instincts to create something. They should press all over the court. Light pressure so you can't get a coach to post. I saw Frank Arnold when he was here at BYU. 2 seconds left. Ball out of bounds right there. He threw it to half court, called a timeout, then got it in and got a great shot. And it's not possible for Benny D's to call something like that if they don't pressure.
Lawzell Williams, number 33, will come in to be the trigger man. They're not going to pressure.
All right, watch deep now. Lechner is surrounded by two people. The key here, the ball must be touched. If this guy throws it long over everybody,
Lechner could win it. Oh, he does. Does it count? Yes, it does.
couldn't get a better one. 6'11", Lechner goes up. No foul. Nothing but the bottom. Eric Lechner, who missed the free throw, goes from goat to hero.
An unbelievable finish for those Cowboys. 60-58 there in the championship game of the WAC tournament. We'll be back to Provo in a moment.
Is made for miracles, and Eric Lechner there vanishing, perhaps the Sports Illustrated jinx, and perhaps Wyoming now ready to start playing the way a lot of folks expected. St. John's and Villanova, last minute, the Garden is rocking. Mike Gorman and Ron Perry.
Clancy, Villanova's got one timeout left. St. John's two. Possession arrow for St. John's.
And now, the Redmond call time. Wow.
What a turnaround.
Wow.
Got to give credit to Villanova's full court press. It's really bothering St. John's, and they forced a turnover and capitalized big time.
Villanova has now...
Alinsky the rebound. He comes out of the pack. They go to chase him. They get it back to Matthews. Over to Wilson.
Too much time.
It's going to be in the backcourt. Are they going to get it out? No, a foul called on Boo Harvey.
Oh, way too much time on St. John's part. You either foul or at that point see if you can get the 10 seconds. However, with 4 seconds, that still is enough time to get a rebound and pass it up court and get like a 30-footer off.
Kenny Wilson has been to the line once tonight.
What a turnaround.
That's an amazing turnaround here. Wilson will step up to the line. All the Villanova players are back. Kenny, the best free throw shooter on the Villanova team, so all the pieces are in place for Rolly. Eight points for Wilson. 70-68 Villanova.
Now all Rolly would be saying is get back defensively, don't foul. And St. John's, if he makes this, they have to get it right to Boo and just try to get it up a little bit over midcourt and launch one and try to tie it up.
4 seconds on the clock.
Craziest things have happened.
Yes, they have. In the last minute, they have. Wilson makes the second.
St. John's with one timeout left, but not enough time. It's really academic. They've got to get it right up and let it go.
Baldy quickly calls the timeout. 1 second goes off the clock, so St. John's and Luke Carnesecca will have 3 seconds.
We have seen it time and again. A lot can happen in 3 seconds. And we'll get back to the Garden in just a second.
This game, 3 seconds to go, 3-point game. Let's get back to it.
Didn't make it. Whoa.
That was a good shot.
Oh, we got a great one from the corner. But the Villanova Wildcats. Down 68-62 with a minute 35 to go in the game, score the final 9 points in regulation, and they have themselves a 71-68 win. Shelton Jones heads down.
17-11. Will that get St. John's into the NCAA field? That's a big, big maybe. Let's now get back to Tim and Dick. We haven't forgotten about you guys in Greensboro. Give us an update and take us through Duke and Virginia. Tim?
All right, Bob, I got the muzzle off Dick and we're ready to go. Only 2 points have been scored in the last...
Don't expect many more seasons like that at Virginia.
Well, you know, as we look at the Duke bench, they're certainly not pleased with their effort. Look at them right there. You would think they're... Well, except there's a big smile, King. But, you know, think about Virginia the year that they went to the Final Four, 84, after losing Ralph Sampson. That team really overachieved. Had some big wins.
Beat Indiana to make it into the Final Four that year after Indiana had knocked off North Carolina.
Yeah, with that real defensive demon job done by Don Dockage against Michael Jordan
right.
down there. Down
Daugherty was still on that team. Matt Daugherty was, I think, a senior on that Carolina team that lost in 84.
That was in Atlanta over the Omni.
Daniel at the line now for Virginia.
I said during that, I'll never forget with Bob Lee in the studio, I said, Bob, let's go to the next game. It's no contest. I said, Michael Jordan and company are a lock to go to Seattle. So all you Carolina people, pack your bags and head to Seattle. Well, Indiana, they greeted me with the largest supporter you could ever get, signed by many of their fans. And I received that at ESPN. Put it in my trophy case.
Every time I think that I've heard all there is to hear from you, I recall the years Bob Lee was with you long before Tim Brando was ever around. And I say to myself, no, wait a minute. Bob Lee's the one that's heard it all.
9 years we've been together. I did my first game back in, the 1st of December, the Paul of Wisconsin, when I was fired in the NBA. Got the Ziggy in 79.
Cook inside to Abdelnaby.
Abdelnaby. And thank goodness it's over.
60-48, our final score. Duke will meet NC State. North Carolina will meet Maryland in our semifinal offering tomorrow. Championship week continues with, guess who, Bob Lee, back in our studio.
9 years, Dick, and I've got the scars to prove it. Duke wins it by the count of 60-48. Among the upsets that you can conceive of, how about Detroit? With only 6 wins this year, possibly getting to the Midwestern Collegiate Final in a tight one with Evansville. You're in Indianapolis with Andy McWilliams and Jerry Harkness.
With you from Market Square Arena. Semifinals of the MCC tournament. Evansville has just taken a 2-point lead, 71-69 over Detroit with 1:35 to play. Got a foul inside on Scott Hafner. He bumped into Bill Wood, and Detroit will have a chance to tie at the free throw line.
Well, Andy, Marty has been struggling throughout the ball game, but he came up with a key 3-point play in the corner to give Evansville the lead. But right now, as you indicated, Detroit sticking right in there, coming into this tournament with just a 5-game victory throughout the season. They have a chance to win two here. Scott Hafner sits on the bench.
That's the 5th foul on Scott Hafner, Evansville's second leading scorer. He'll watch the rest of this one from the bench. It's 71-69, Evansville by 2 with 1:33 to play. Aces struggled tonight. They trailed by 8 at the half. Heavily favored, Evansville with a 20-6 record coming in. Had to fight all night long against this upstart Detroit team. Bill Wood missing the free throw. Great effort by Godfrey to keep it in for Evansville. And a foul on Detroit's Darian McKinney in the backcourt to put Marty Simmons at the line.
Well, a lot of time still to go in the ball game. He missed that key free throw Wood did as a freshman, but the foul, McKinney trying with all that enthusiasm, not a good foul, especially against Marty Simmons, who's a great free throw shooter.
Simmons stepped to the line. He shoots him 82%. He's a senior. 6th leading scorer in the country. On the way. Detroit off with a rebound. Simmons with a rare pressure miss from the line. Detroit down 2. They upset St. Louis last night on the doorstep of a major upset tonight. Here is Tullis in traffic shooting off the side of the board. Bill Wood comes off with it. Tullis again. Can't get the shot off. It goes out of bounds in Detroit. Now they're going to give it to Evansville with 1:06 to play.
Still a lot of time in the ball game. Good defense by Evansville on that particular play. As you see, Detroit picking up Evansville all over the court, hoping to get a turnover.
Inbounding for the freshman, Milt Donald. Evansville with a basketball and a 2-point lead. Under a minute to play now. Bill Wood with the reach-in foul. He will put Beltra Dawson at the line. Dawson, a 67% foul shooter. Archie Tullis has had a tremendous game for Detroit. Number 14, 38 points for Tullis.
That is an excellent game. And another fellow that had an excellent second half is on the bench, and Scotty Hafner. He brought him back in the ball game. I believe he had 5 3-pointers. So I tell you, Andy, Evansville does not want to go into overtime against Detroit with a player like Detroit. I like Scotty Hafner on the bench.
Critical free throw, Beltra Dawson with his 16th point of the ball game. He's the senior transfer from Villanova.
played for the Wildcats in 85 when they won the national championship. He can put his team up by four, and he does. Boston with 17 on the ball game. 73-69, Evansville by four. Marvin Owens for Detroit. Kennedy, a three-point try. Drilled it! Kennedy, a three-pointer.
These guys are unbelievable. They never say die. Here, Kennedy, not noted for the three-point shooting, comes up with a key three-point play. They're back in the ball game.
73-72, Evansville up by a point, and they're going to run some time off the clock. Shot clock has 25. Game clock is at 27. Slight difference.
They're going to have to foul them. If they can't get the steal, they definitely have to foul. It's not enough to get a basket or get a score.
Down to 15 seconds. Simmons out top for Milt Donald. There's the guy they want to foul, but he got rid of the ball. Now Simmons is hacked by Mike Brown with 9 seconds to go, and Simmons will go to the line with Evansville up 73-72. Almost fouled Milt Donald, who is the poor free throw shooter.
They had a chance. They did foul him, but not in time. I tell you, that's the man you don't want to foul is Marty Simmons. He missed one, but he's not going to miss them all in the second half. He'll hit these with key times, especially as we go down the stretch with 9 seconds to go.
Marty Simmons double-teamed out top. Tullis tried for the steal. Mike Brown reaching in, but that was the foul call, and Simmons will go to the free throw line.
Andy, I think you hit it on the nose. They really had a better opportunity. Anything can happen now. Simmons could miss the front end of the one-and-one, but you definitely would deal with the percentages. You would have liked the freshman to go on the line.
Well, the winner of this game will play the 20th-rated Xavier Musketeers in tomorrow night's championship game here at Market Square, and that'll be a 7 o'clock start. Musketeers coming off a lopsided victory over Loyola, 38-point win over Loyola in the first game here tonight. 73-72, Evansville up by a point.
Uncharacteristic of Evansville. From the line, 13 for 24 for just 54%. They are a really good free throw shooting team during the regular season. As you take a look at Detroit, 15 out of 24 for 63%.
Whoever wins this game has a rather difficult hill to climb tomorrow against a very good Xavier team.
Well, anything can happen in tournament play, especially in this particular tournament. Xavier, no doubt it would be the heavy favorite, but we also saw St. Louis, the heavy favorite, as well as Butler, the heavy favorite. Both of them go down by defeat.
38 points for Archie Tullis. Here's the key guy, Marty Simmons with 20. Shooting the front end of the one and one. He gets it. It's a two-point ball game.
And you notice that Coach Jim Cruz has pulled all of his players off of the line for defensive purposes so that they're ready once he hits both shots.
Only 9 seconds left. Simmons misses. Detroit can tie it with a two, win it with a three. Tullis now from the perimeter. In the bucket! He fired it home, a three-pointer! Detroit wins it! 75-74, Archie Tullis!
They're not sure if it was a three-point play. They're saying that he was not in three-point area.
Oh, it was definitely a three-pointer.
Yes, definitely. Definitely.
41 points for Tullis. Now they say there's 1-2 seconds left on the clock. Here it is, Tullis. Archie Tullis from the perimeter. Double-teamed and he drills it. Jim Cruz lobbying for a technical foul against Detroit because they'd come on the floor with time still left on the clock. I don't think they're going to call the technical. You might have heard about a similar situation in the ECAC playoffs involving Fairfield and St. Peter's when Mitch Bonaguro and his Fairfield team came on the floor with 1 second left. They thought the game was over. Technical foul on the coach. They lose the game at the free throw line.
you can't say enough about Archie Tullis. He's been the key. They needed him. He came through. He's double team, as you've indicated. He's got that quick release. He's 24, 25 feet away. Nothing but net. 2 seconds to go, and now they're changing that. Well, on there, they're showing it. They got it back to 2 seconds. So anything can happen.
And everyone was anticipating an Evansville Xavier championship game.
But Detroit has played inspired basketball throughout the entire tournament. And this is indicative of those guys. They're young. They got a lot of determination and drive. And McKinney Tullis is their leader. He's done a great job. And they're going to be back.
Detroit came in at 5-22. They were the final seed in this tournament. Last night, they beat St. Louis by 3. And tonight, they're on the verge of upsetting Evansville. Detroit, as I said, had only 3 Division I victories in the regular season. They beat a Division II and a Division III team. Now, Detroit calls a timeout after seeing what Evansville...
He's an interim coach.
I think Detroit should scratch out that interim and make him permanent.
I'd give him my vote. The way he's gotten these guys, especially, they're so inspired, but you can be sure it's going to go to Simmons.
Chris Bamba will put it in play. And he lost the ball off his hand, and that's the ball game. Chris Bamba could not get it in play. That's it. Detroit advances to the final to play the 20th-rated Xavier Musketeers tomorrow night here at Market Square Arena. Final score, Detroit 74, Evansville. Detroit 75, Evansville 74 in an upset. We'll be back after...
Upset does not begin to describe this game. Let me tell you a few things about Detroit. They started out with 7 straight losses. Coach Don Seco quit. Then John Mulroy got the head coaching job. They proceeded to lose 7 more games. They did not win a basketball game this year until the 20th of January when they defeated Tiny John Carroll of Cleveland. They came into this game with a record of 6-22. They have knocked off Evansville, a team with 20 victories. Archie Tullis, a man who, on the night that he had 49 points to set a Detroit record, break Terry Duron's record that he set back in 1979. It was his fate to go nose up against Hersey Hawkins the night that Hawkins set his individual record over 60 points. What an incredible game. Tell us, with that 3-pointer from the outside, any other player on the floor you would say wouldn't have a shot of going in. It went in. Detroit will play Xavier for a trip to the NCAAs. Detroit with a record of 7-22. Xavier defeated Loyola tonight, 117-79, as Byron Larkin had 32. We say it so often, March is made for miracles. And news out of Tennessee, where the Volunteers have now given Don DeVoe a contract extension. His situation had been up in the air. Late word in tonight from Knoxville that indeed the university has extended his contract. So Don DeVoe's situation has been settled. We're going to step aside for 30 minutes. SportsCenter with Alan and Tom with everything happening in sports.